Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to L'Auberge Chez François. I know what you're thinking. Well, he sort of looks the part, but where's the French accent? And how did he get a job as chef at L'Auberge Chez François without one? Well, my dad owns the place. I have to confess that. And I feel better confessing that. I really do. He's the one with the French accent, and actually he's taught me just about everything I know. And at 80 years old, he comes to work every day, tells me what I'm doing wrong. But that just goes to show you the importance of good food. And today we're celebrating Valentine's Day. And what would Valentine's Day be without oysters? You need them. The first dish we're going to do is oysters with a horseradish sauce. Les huîtres au réfort. See, you didn't think I could speak French. Here we go. And the first thing we need are a few oysters. That always helps. There are so many different types of oysters now that are available. You know, oyster consumption in the United States has gone up at least 25% in the last 3 or 4 years. It used to be you could hardly give them away, but now everyone wants those oysters. They're delicious. I know when I go to France, that's what I have for lunch. Oysters and steak tartare. These are Malpec oysters from Malpec Bay near Prince Edward Island in Canada. The great thing about having FedEx and UPS around is we can get fresh food from all over the planet delivered to us in a day or so. Now, you need to crack those oysters open, and I'll give you a little demonstration. What you do is you take your oyster knife and place it in the wedge behind the oyster, in the back of the oyster, put it in the wedge, push it in just a little, and then twist, okay? Now, at this point, stop, because oftentimes there is a fair amount of dirt just on in the hinge right there. Wipe off the knife and then go back in there and scrape the top of the oyster, like so, to get the top shell off, okay? And you have your oyster. Now, sometimes there's a piece of shell, as we have here. You look if there's a little bit of dirt, you clean that off. Whatever you do, don't rinse the oyster. Let me do one more for you. Any questions on this?
Jacques, you said top side. Is there really a top and bottom of an oyster?
Yeah, there really is a top and a bottom of the oyster. On many of them, the bottom is a little bit deeper, and you want to try to conserve those juices, keep those juices in the oysters, because we're going to use some of the juice. We're going to collect some to put in the sauce. There certainly is. Now, it has happened that it is broken, that the bottom is broken and you flip it over, but most of the time, if you do it right and a little practice, and I know that you all aren't going to be opening oysters. However, you can always go, you can always buy a pint of Selex, but you didn't hear it from me. Now, we're going to serve them by putting them a little rock salt in a plate. This is going to hold them in place. Keep the oysters in a plate because any of the juices that flow out, we're going to use in the sauce. Let's put those oysters in the rock salt, all the while conserving any juices that happen to end up in the dish right there. I think about 5 oysters as an appetizer is a good amount. Raw food is very essential to the diet, or very lightly cooked food is essential to the diet. And here is definitely a pure, whole food that is delicious. Now, we're going to take about a cup of heavy whipping cream. Boy, they were mighty stingy with that heavy whipping cream. I always keep a gallon in the refrigerator at home. You know, in case a guest comes, you know what I'm saying? You might, a little bit more sauce here, right? Okay. And this is a simple recipe. It is heavy whipping cream, a little salt and pepper, right here, and about 1/2 teaspoon of freshly grated horseradish. You can certainly use the prepared horseradish. It'll work very, very nicely. And all we're going to do is boil this down until it thickens enough to coat the oysters. Now, we're going to take any juices that have come off the pan here, and that's your sauce. Now, how do you tell when your sauce is thick enough? People always ask me that. Boil your cream for a little bit, and when it will coat a spoon, and I hope everybody can see that, you take your finger and run across it. And if that line holds, can everyone see that?
Yeah.
If that line holds, then that sauce is just thick enough and ready to go. It just takes a minute or two. It doesn't take any time, which is a great, it's a great medium for making sauces. Okay, there's 40% butter fat. Class, what's wrong with butter?
Nothing!
There you go. Now that we got that straight. Now, two ways to do this. If I were fixing it for myself, I would just take the oysters on the plate that way and put the hot sauce over it, and that's warm enough. Many people, I'm sure, would just as soon take those oysters, put them in the oven for 2 or 3 minutes, or put them under the broiler just to warm them up a little bit, and then put the sauce on top. But I'm going to fix it my way here. What the heck? The sauce is hot anyway. We're going to put it right on top of the oysters. Not too much. Serve the rest of the sauce on the side if you have a little bit of extra, like that. Simple. Now, if you're really feeling frisky and you want to add a little extra touch of spice, you might take a little bit of salmon caviar. The other caviar will do nicely, but I think the color is good on this. And just put a little bit of caviar on the oysters. Every little bit helps. Voila. Can everyone see that? I like them this way. They're good. They're delicious. You haven't killed all those enzymes, and you need that butter fat. You know you do. You know you want it. You know you do. You just think there's something wrong with it. It is often the artificial, the devitalized foods, the skeletalized foods, if you will, and the oils, which have been overprocessed and everything, that I believe are the problem. Stick with pure, whole food, and I think you're going to be 100% ahead of the game. Any questions on that? Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I know here at L'Auberge Chez François on Valentine's Day, lobster is the dish that you can't keep in the kitchen. It's the most ordered dish in the restaurant, so no Valentine's Day menu would be complete without it. And today we're going to do what I think is one of my favorite lobster dishes. It's a lobster with a champagne bill blanc. Robert, could you bring that lobster in? All right, here we go. I've cooked this a little bit ahead because it's kind of hot to handle, and I don't want to burn my little pinkies. You know, all right. There are two schools of thought out there when it comes to cooking a lobster. There are steamers and there are plungers. I'm definitely a plunger. You can take the lobster in a steamer, right here. Put it in there and you steam it for about 10, 12 minutes. The problem with that is you're never quite sure if it's done all the way through. And since you're going to reheat it in this dish, you don't want to cook it too very much. What I like to do is just, maybe if I had a towel it would work better here, eliminate this, set it over here, and take the lobster and put it right in a boiling cool bouillon, that is an aromatic broth, even in salted water. You put the lobster into the boiling broth or just salted water, put it on full steam, and soon as the water or the broth boils again, you pull that lobster out. That's cooked enough. That way there's no question that you've overcooked the lobster. Let's say we've steamed our lobster and let it cool just a little bit, and I want to show you how to prepare it here. There we go. And for this particular endeavor, we want a real knife. A genuine lobster knife. None of these anemic things. That's really why I became a chef, because handling a knife like this makes you feel like a man. Eat your heart out, Arnold Schwarzenegger. Look at this thing. This is a bad boy. We're going to separate the claws. All right. Oh, this one already fell apart for us. That's nice. Almost. All right. We're going to crack the claws and remove the meat and split this lobster in half lengthwise. In this particular case, you can't ask your fishmonger to do it, all right? And put that lobster right there. We're going to take the meat out of the tail, at least loosen it a little bit, like that. I like to take and clean out the top of the shell here, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. We have the two lobster tails here, split in half, and then I've taken the top part of the shell and just removed the legs on the side and rinsed it out a little bit, because this is part of our decor. I want to keep a simple dish that you can do at home, but I want to make it so it looks a little bit elegant and shows off your lobster a bit. To make the beurre blanc, we're going to take some vinegar. Why use plain old vinegar when you can use champagne vinegar? It's Valentine's Day. About a tablespoon of champagne vinegar, some shallots, some finely chopped shallots. We're going to take a little pepper, a bit of champagne. I'm going to use one from my father's part of France. We can't really call it champagne. It's a Cremant. It's a sparkling Riesling. Oh, that sound. Oh. You could certainly do this with white wine. A traditional beurre blanc, a white butter sauce, is made with white wine. But why not a little champagne? We're going to take our shallots, white wine, vinegar, champagne vinegar if you like, and reduce it down until it's almost dry. And I'm going to put a bay leaf, a clove, and again, we put a little cracked pepper in there. And when it's finished reducing, it's going to look like this. Almost dry. Be careful not to reduce it or you'll scorch it, and then you won't be able to use it. You'll have to start again. Now, a beurre blanc, besides this reduction, is merely butter. Class, what's wrong with butter?
Nothing.
I think they're getting the hang of it. I really do. All right. We're going to take butter, in this case, about a stick and a half. You think that's enough for two? Oh. Let's put in two sticks of butter. Let's put in two sticks of butter, because we'll put a little bit on the lobster and we'll serve the rest on the side. All right.
How do you stay so thin after eating all those buttery sauces?
How do I stay so thin after eating all those buttery sauces? Ma'am, my daddy always said a good rooster is never fat. Does that answer the question? All right. We're going to reduce, speaking of reduce, we're going to reduce the heat and whisk in the softened butter. Now, a beurre blanc is easy to make, but you must continue to shake the pan, monter au beurre, as they say in France. You mustn't let the butter just sit in the pan or it will separate. As it melts, it must be incorporated, emulsified, if you will, into the sauce. So you can either do it this way, or you can take your whisk and keep it going until the butter is incorporated into the sauce, a little bit at a time. And you can see we've done this in real time, other than a reduction, which only takes 3 or 4 minutes anyway. And again, you can make this ahead. You can keep it warm. You can put it over a pot of water, a bain-marie, if you will, or a double boiler, and just keep it slightly warm and tepid. We here at the restaurant would strain this sauce, put it through a fine strainer, but it's absolutely not necessary at home. Okay. A little taste. a little more salt and pepper. I like to use mineral or sea salt. That's why I have a salt mill here. There is, some people say, a problem with the very fine salt that pours, that there's aluminum in it, so it stays, but so it's able to pour. In that, they also put a little dextrose, which is sugar, to hide the taste of the aluminum.
Okay, so we got two sticks of butter, and we're worried about the aluminum and the salt.
A man after my own heart. Everything you can do. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, the gentleman here makes a very good point. If you have to worry about every bite and every sip, the stress is going to kill you long before the cholesterol. You do the best you can. You certainly don't stop doing a dish just because, oh, I can't find an organic carrot. I use as much organic produce as I can, meats that are hormone-free, et cetera, et cetera. You do the best you can. If you have a choice, you get them. If you don't, you enjoy it. We have our beurre blanc with two sticks of butter in it and a little bit of sea salt. All right, let me just show you the presentation that I like to use. Since it's wintertime, it's Valentine's Day, we are going to take some exotic fruit, in this case mango, which you can find. Papaya would certainly work well, and put it into the shell here. Lobster can be a very elegant dish, and I think it's straightforward and relatively simple. And the beurre blanc, which is a little tart with the vinegar and the wine or champagne, whatever you're using, really sets off the sweetness of the fruit very, very nicely, and the sweetness of the lobster. The problem is you get this far, and what do you do? How do you heat this back up? Cover the platter with foil or another plate and put it in the oven and just warm it through. Do not do this too far ahead of time. Again, have your friend or spouse or whomever is sitting next to you that you're going to prepare for this. Heat it up a little bit. Get the sauce warm. Okay. Now, for presentation purposes, I like to leave, especially when heating it, I like to leave the lobster shell on the tail. But to serve it, I like to remove it. Okay, right there. It tends to, when reheated, shrink if you're not careful. You just want to very lightly reheat it and get it through. This is not very hard. We're going to take our claws and put them right on there, if they hold up, right on the mango, which sets it off very nicely. We're going to take the knuckles, the meat that came out of the knuckles of the claw, and put it on in the center there. Let me put that over here. There's one finishing touch that I like to put in the beurre blanc, and that is a little freshly grated ginger right here. Again, it's a little spicy, and I think served with the fruit, which is, it just sets it off. It gives it a little bit of hint of heat. We're going to put that in there. Not very much, maybe about only a quarter teaspoon for this recipe. Mix it up. Now, what do you do if the beurre blanc separates? Let it cool and heat it. Warm it very, very slowly while whisking, and it should re-emulsify. That's the best way to do it. So we have heated our lobster, whichever way you do. Again, steaming it back up there is a good way to do it. And we're going to take a spoon here, if I can find one, and just take our beurre blanc and put it over the slightly warmed lobster. Voila. Just take a little kiwi, which you can get most of the year, and a few orange segments, let's say back here. All of which goes great with that beurre blanc. Clean up our mess a little bit. And there you have it. Any questions on the lobsters, ladies and gentlemen?
Is there an easy way to get the claw meat out in one piece?
Well, I can try to show you that. When it's still warm, this is cooled down, you know, usually you crack it like this and try to get out. The other way to do it is to just open it like this and twist like that, and then pull like this, pull the claw down like this, and then Thank you very much. And today we're going to prepare a warm chocolate tart. Nothing like a warm tart for dessert, I always say. We're going to take a little heavy whipping cream, 40% butterfat. You know, fat always gets the bad rap. It's fat that makes you fat. Well, listen, even I couldn't make this up. A brand new study has come out in a prestigious journal that said it's actually even more important than fat and carbs and everything is your marital status. Oh, absolutely. You see, it goes like this. A single person comes home, looks in the refrigerator, shrugs, and goes to bed. A married person comes home, looks in the bed, shrugs, and goes to the refrigerator. That's fattening. That's very fattening. Why blame butter all the time? All right, we're going to take two-thirds of a cup of that heavy whipping cream, and I'm giving you a break this recipe. I'm putting a quarter cup of milk. We're going to scald the milk and heavy cream combination and give that a boil. In the meantime, I'm going to take two whole free-range organic eggs. They are out there, ladies and gentlemen. Use them. And I'm going to whisk them very, very well. We're going to whisk the eggs. We're going to scald the milk here and cream. And then we're going to take 8 ounces of semi-sweet chocolate. Where is this chocolate from? France, of course. And we're going to make what is called a ganache. Once we've scalded that, we're just going to put the chocolate, which we've cut up a little bit, and just melt it into the heavy whipping cream and milk combination. Again, if you're feeling frisky, you want to put a little rum in here or some sort of liqueur, that will work. But since I've already overdone that in all the other recipes, we'll just leave it the way it is here. We are melting. We are making a ganache. We have melted the chocolate in there. We're going to whisk the warm chocolate into the egg. Now, a little trick for you, if I can find the pan. Here we go. Unless you have a scantily clad assistant to help you, which is something we're going to have in the budget for the next round of shows, I'm sure. I'm going to take a damp towel and put the bowl in a little pan here to hold it. Because if you put the bowl on the counter, it's just going to run away from you. Let's get this spatula out of here. And pour very slowly, because you do not want to cook the eggs prematurely. Slowly pour the melted chocolate and cream into the eggs. This is an easy recipe. By gosh, you can do it. All right, now we're going to take a pre-baked, this is about an 8-inch, 7.5 or 8-inch pie crust. That's enough for two, isn't it? for chocoholics, I mean?
Barely,
exactly. And listen, what you don't eat for dinner, you can, for breakfast. You just reheat that pie right up for breakfast. We're making a mess here. Take our, and again, a little rum, a Grand Marnier or some other liqueur in there. Fill our pie crust, pre-baked, with the chocolate mixture. We're going to bake it about 10 minutes at 350 degrees. How do you tell if it's ready? Because I don't know about your oven, but mine at home is notoriously off. Here at the restaurant, I have somebody come in at least every month or 6 weeks to calibrate the ovens. At home, I've never tried it. I have no idea. Get a little kitchen thermometer, but if you don't have that, just take a skewer, as you would for any cake, and put it into the chocolate, and if it comes out clean, it's set and ready to go. So our 10 minutes are up. Hey, it's TV, guys. And we have our warm pie. We are going to put it carefully, there we go, onto our pan. Of course, you're going to have a rose there naturally. And voila, you have a warm chocolate tart. I have here some chocolate curls, or cigarette as they're called, some chocolate that we've just scraped with a potato peeler off a block of chocolate or a little bit of confectioner's sugar. Hey, desserts are a different animal. Enjoy them. Put a little powdered sugar on them. Again, this can certainly be made ahead. Just put it back in the oven for 4 or 5 minutes, 350 degree oven, just to warm it. It should be served just slightly warm. Take a little bit of chocolate around it. It would go great with a scoop of vanilla ice cream. Or listen, take some creme fraiche and ladle it on top, and I think you have a delicious dessert. And a great ending for a Valentine's Day meal. Well, I need to get my real Valentine to come up here and share this dessert with me. Carol, can you come on up here? Happy Valentine's Day. Ladies and gentlemen, fix a romantic meal for someone that you love. It works. Thank you very much. Oh,